invite you to stand if you're able for our opening hymn, O Come All Ye Faithful. The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light.
The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome.
Those who dwelt in the land of deep darkness, on them light has shined.
We have beheld Christ's glory, glory as of the only Son from the Father.
For unto us a child is born, to us a son is given. May the grace and truth of Christ be with you all.
And also with you.
Merry Christmas.
Yeah, so you may be seated. He stole my line. So wonderful to have all of you here with us today as we celebrate God made flesh, Christ the King. Please know that all are welcome today to join us in communion. We'll give further instruction as the service goes on. Also know that during our time of offering, we have lots of ways that you can give as you are comfortable. We will pass the plate, but in our bulletin, there's also information if you would like to give either by text or by phone. There's details on that. Please also know that you are most welcome to join us on any Sunday for worship. During the Christmas season, so this coming Sunday, we'll worship just one service at 9:30, but typically we have two services at 8:30 and 10:45. And then we also want to invite you, on January 6th, we are going to have an Epiphany burning of the greens, which is a fancy liturgical way of saying a really, really big fire, where we're going to burn all of our Christmas trees and wreaths and garland and sing some Christmas carols one final time as we end our Christmas season and move into Epiphany. At this time, we are going to have a children's message. So kids are invited forward, and we can sit around the communion rail. And I'm going to grab my stick. So if there's some kids that want to join me this afternoon. Yeah, all right. Great. Well, good afternoon, boys and girls. How are you all doing? Are you really excited for Christmas? Yeah, me too. Do you see this special wreath that we have right up here? So we've been lighting this wreath for the last 4 weeks of Advent. And the word Advent means arrival. So throughout the season of Advent, we've been waiting for Christ's arrival on Christmas. And so each week, we've lit a different candle. And can you tell which candle we've been burning the longest? Which one's the shortest? Is it this one? No. Is it this one? No. Is it this one? Yeah, so this one is the shortest. And maybe some of the grown-ups out here might be able to help us too. Do you remember what the first candle meant? What it was called? Yeah, the prophet's candle. And so the prophet's candle was about the prophets who told us about Jesus going to come and be born, the Messiah, and it signifies hope. And then the next week, we had the Bethlehem candle, which represented faith, and we were told that Jesus, or the Messiah, was going to be born in Bethlehem. And the third week, which was last Sunday, we had the shepherd's candle, which represented joy. Because do you know who the first people to hear about Jesus being born were? They were shepherds. And they were so excited. They went and met the Christ child. And then they went and left with joy and told everybody what they had seen. And then just yesterday, we lit this candle, which is called the peace candle or the angel's candle, because the angels told that Christ was going to bring peace. So what candle is left for us to light then that hasn't been lit yet? Yeah, which one? Yeah, the white one in the middle. So is it different than the other candles? Yeah, because what color are the other candles? Yes, that one represents the baby Jesus, doesn't it? Yeah, very good job. Little baby Kendall? Is that a friend? Helper? Oh, a baby candle. Oh, yes, you have your candle for tonight, don't you? Yeah, that's so exciting. Yeah, the candles, that is really exciting. And so this light, which we're going to light in just a minute, is the Christ candle. And so that one represents Christ. And the white helps us to remember the light and the purity that Jesus brings for us. So we're going to light the candles. And I'm going to say a word after I light each candle. And will you repeat, everyone repeat that word after I say it? Hope. Dramatic pause. Faith.
Faith.
Joy. Peace.
Peace.
Christ.
Christ.
And will you pray with me by repeating after me? Dear God,
thank you for sending Jesus,
that all may know your love. It's through his name that we pray. Amen. All right, thanks for coming up today, kids. You can head back to your seats, and we'll continue with the musical message.
Our weakness is no strength. The Old Testament lesson is from the book of the prophet Isaiah, chapter 9, verses 2 to 7. A reading from Isaiah. The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who lived in a land of deep darkness, on them light has shined. You have multiplied the nation. You have increased its joy. They rejoice before you as with joy at the harvest, as people exult when dividing plunder. For the yoke of their burden and the bar across their shoulders, the rod of their oppressor, you have broken as on the day of Midian. For all the boots of the trampling warriors and all the garments rolled in blood shall be burned as fuel for the fire. For a child has been born for us, a son given to us. Authority rests upon his shoulders, and he is named Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. His authority shall grow continually, and there shall be endless peace for the throne of David and his kingdom. He will establish and uphold it with justice and with righteousness from this time onward and forevermore. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will do this. The word of the Lord.
You got excited just like us. Will you rise as you are able for the first part of our gospel reading? In those days, a decree went out from Emperor Augustus that all the world should be registered. This was the first registration and was taken while Quirinius was governor of Syria. All went to their own towns to be registered. Joseph also went from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to the city of David called Bethlehem, because he was descended from the house and family of David. He went to be registered with Mary, to whom he was engaged and who was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for her to deliver her child. And she gave birth to her firstborn son and wrapped him in bands of cloth and laid him in a manger, because there was no place for them in the inn. In that region there were shepherds living in the fields, keeping watch over their flock by night. Then an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid, for see, I am bringing you good news of great joy for all the people. To you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign for you. You will find a child wrapped in bands of cloth and lying in a manger." And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of heavenly hosts, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace among those whom he favors." The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let us go now to Bethlehem and see this thing that has taken place, which the Lord has made known to us." So they went with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the child lying in the manger. When they saw this, they made known what had been told them about this child. And all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds had told them. But Mary treasured all these words and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all they had heard and seen, as it had been told them. The Gospel of our Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. You may be seated. Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and from our incarnate Lord and Savior, Jesus the Christ. Amen. Have you ever said to yourself, "Gosh, I could go for a really good, deep, difficult theological conversation right about now?" I guess I hang out with too many pastors because we think that's kind of fun. Well, if you ever want to have a good, difficult, deep theological conversation, just talk to a kid. I'm serious. Some of the best, most thoughtful questions of faith I've heard have come out of the mouths and minds of children. So here's a good one I was asked just last Sunday. Was Jesus actually born on Christmas? Now, like most good questions, there's a few folds or layers to that question. Because Christmas is actually made up of two different words, Christ, meaning Christ, and Mass, meaning Mass or a worship service. So Christmas is the day of worship that we have to celebrate Christ's arrival or Christ's birth in the world. So yes, Christmas is actually Jesus' birthday, because Christ's Mass celebrates that the day God became flesh, the day God became incarnate, birthed as a baby. But, and this is where it gets a little deeper, the question she really wanted to know is, was Jesus actually born on December 25th? And the truth is, we don't know if Jesus was actually born on December 25th. None of the gospel accounts tell us a date. It isn't recorded in the earliest historical writings of that period. And the first celebration of Christmas isn't actually recorded until Emperor Constantine in the 300s. For those earlier Christian communities, Easter held the primary and really the sole focus of their large festival worships. So, like any good theologian, the first question led to another question and to another question. So if we don't actually know that Christmas is December 25th, why is Christmas December 25th? So this is where things get really interesting. Did you know that Friday was our longest night of the year? So the sun rose at 8:04 a.m. and it set at 4:37. So that means for most of us, when we left our homes that morning, it was dark. Yeah. And when we drove home from work or after school or those last minute or maybe first minute Christmas errands, it was dark. In fact, the world right now kind of feels pretty dark. I mean, there's been tragedies and heartache both around the globe and right here in our own homes and community. And so we gather this afternoon on one of the darkest, longest nights of the year to proclaim, "A light shines in the darkness, and the darkness cannot overcome it." So in a while, we will fill this room with candlelight and remember that the light has come into this world. So we celebrate because even though the darkness seems so constant right now, it is defeated by the flicker of even one candle. In fact, on the darkest of nights, our eye could see a flickering candle, just one candle, 30 miles away. There weren't any trees in the way, that is. So the light shines in the darkness, and the darkness cannot overcome it. So we gather on one of the darkest, longest nights of the year to proclaim that the light, Christ, has come. But December 25th is also important because we are on the other side of the longest night. In fact, our days are getting longer. Our nights are getting shorter. I looked it up when we have 4 more minutes of daylight today than we did on Friday. And tomorrow, we're going to get another 2 minutes. But then we're going to get another 2 minutes and another 2 minutes and another 2 minutes. And they're going to keep adding together until somehow, almost without our noticing, it's going to be daylight both when we wake up and when we go home from our daily work. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness cannot overcome it. So there's an invitation that we all receive as we celebrate Christ's arrival to the world. And we are invited to bear the light of Christ and to share it with everyone we meet. Now that might seem like a big task, or it might seem like an overwhelming task, wondering, can the light from one candle really make a difference? But we remember, we don't go alone. We go together. So may you be reminded of that as we pass the light around the sanctuary and as we sing together this evening. May you be reminded of that as the daylight sneaks longer and longer in the coming days and weeks and months. You are invited to let your whole life bear the light of Christ. And please know, if you don't feel like you have a light to share, if the world around you is just too dark, or if your grief seems too big and too overwhelming, please know we will bear the light for you and with you. You may not see it, but when we sing, your face is going to shine, reflecting the candlelight of Christ. It means you are known, you are covered, you are loved by the one who came as a baby and transform the whole world, born on Christmas. Thanks be to God for this gift of light. Amen. You may stay seated as we sing together.
Invite you now as we receive the offering and tithes. You may pull out your phones and use those as well, and invite you also to get up and use the kiosk in the office if you so desire. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, and broke it, gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, gave it for them to drink, saying, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in remembrance of me." And let us pray the prayer our Lord taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Reminder that all are welcome to the Lord's table, and we will have three communion stations this afternoon, so two in the front for either side here, and we're going to have a third station over there by the chairs, and we would invite people sitting in the chairs or up in the balcony to come to the third station. And a reminder for you to please go around to the back of the chairs to receive your communion, and then you can go back to your seats in front of the chairs, whether you're in the balcony or in the chairs. Invite the assistants forward at this time, and all are welcome. Gluten-free, if you desire gluten-free, that will be at the left station here. Come, for all things are ready. Let us pray. God of wonder, in Jesus we behold the light of the world come near. And as you have come among us now, send us out in joy, hastening to share the good news of your love. We ask this in the name of Jesus, through the Spirit dwelling among us now and forever. Amen. And now a reading from John chapter 1, verses 1 through 14. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God, and all things came into being through him, and without him, not one thing came into being. What has come into being in him was life, and the life was a light of all people. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not overcome it. And there was a man sent from God whose name was John, and he came as a witness to testify to the light, so that all might believe through him. And he himself was not the light, but he came to testify to the light. The true light, which enlightens everyone, was coming into the world, and he was in the world, and the world came into being through him. Yet the world did not know him. And he came to what was his own, and his own people did not accept him. But to all who received him, who believed in his name, he gave the power to become children of God, who were born not of blood or of the will of the flesh or of the will of man, but of God. And the Word became flesh and lived among us, and we have seen his glory, the glory as of a Father's only Son, full of grace and truth. The Gospel of the Lord. As we participate in the candle lighting, just a safety precaution for you, a reminder that if you are one that has the light, you keep the light still and up and down vertical. The one who needs the light, you tip yours horizontally to get the light from your neighbor. That's just for our safety precaution. I would invite the ushers forward now as we light the candles. I would invite you to stand if you're able. And the ushers to turn off the lights, please. And now, God the Creator who delights in you, Jesus the Savior who is born for you, and the life-giving Spirit who shines on you, bless you and keep you in hope and peace. Amen. Go in peace, serve the Lord.